It's been a long, hard road, a lot of failures along the way, and I'm going to tell you about them. I hope you'll enjoy it, and don't be afraid to laugh, because there was some laughing along the way as well. So back in the 70s, when frankly I was still a kid, this was my version of VTOL. Now these aren't my aircraft, these are off the internet, but I built ones just like these, and they flew quite well, actually. And then by the 80s, I was a young adult, just having graduated college and just beginning my career, wherein I tried to invent the multicopter, quadcopter, actually. And this is me. Boy, I had a lot of hair back then. and that was my attempt at a quadcopter. As you can see, the batteries, the motors, they were not up to the task at that time. I mean, that battery came out of that Nissan truck. And even so, it barely had enough power to get off the ground. Bob, can you flip the slide, please? So this is a little close-up view, and forgive the old photograph. But, I mean, we're talking brushed motors, external gear reduction on the propellers, mechanical gyros, literally electric motors spinning with metal discs and on a little teeter-totter with a feedback pot and electronic circuitry. I mean, this is the best we had, or at least that I could afford, used for model helicopter tail rotors. And then this pile of wire, there's even a NiCad battery in there to power the receiver, and the whole thing was so heavy. I mean, by the time it got off the ground, the sparks were flying from the brushes everywhere, and the motors were not stable at all. And the best it ever did was get about 2 or 3 feet off the ground and wobble around a bit. So I guess you call that a success. Anyway, so after that, I decided to try something with glow fuel, alcohol-based fuel, I'm sure you know. And I built this aircraft intending that it would never be a full transition to forward flight, to do what I now call slow forward flight. So, and as you can see, since I had just one motor, I was ducting part of the propeller disc out the back, and I had control surfaces in the back for pitch and yaw. And initially, I had little puffer jets out the wingtips. That did not work at all. There wasn't just enough mass flow to do it. Of course, I didn't know that back then, but it didn't work. So go ahead and flip the slide. And I added this vertical surface below, which actually did work for roll. So I had all three axes, but I had no flight controller, at least not that was available to me. I'm sure you all had them at that time. But so I was relying on my reflexes, which were never that good. It did sort of almost fly. I mean, at full throttle, it could barely hover. It seemed like power was always a problem. And I think the best it ever did was stagger through the air about 20 feet and manage to land on its wheels. Not that it always did, but that was the best it ever did. So let's keep going. Then along came the 90s, and you know, other priorities ensued. So this is my son, Cody, and 10 years later, I invented the selfie. And Cody was not impressed, as you can tell. So we'll go on. But also, right around 2000, you know, we had the dot-com boom and then the bust. And like a lot of people here in the Bay Area, I lost my job. As a matter of fact, I lost it for a couple of years. So I had a little money, not much, and a lifelong love of this sort of thing, and I tried to build another VTOL because I hadn't had enough success yet. So, and go ahead and flip it. I tried this, I guess I'll call it a double ring wing. And it looks like it might have worked. It actually had an interesting engine, something called an RCV-60. Which is it's kind of an interesting engine because the propeller basically bolts on top of the cylinder head. The whole cylinder spins around, and it's a four-stroke. So, and by the virtue of the way it works, it has a 2-to-1 gear reduction, which I thought would help me get enough thrust. And I put this thing on a test stand, and I measured it, and I tried to be scientific about it. But ultimately, I failed again because it just did not have quite enough thrust to fly. Eventually, I got frustrated with it, trying to hover, and I literally threw it into the air. Now, my test pilot, some of you may know Zach West, who was probably 15 at the time. And he had those wonderful 15-year-old reflexes. He flew it for me. And by the way, this actually had the first beginnings of a flight controller, at least for me. It had electronic stabilization. This little dark spot in the middle of the fuselage, there's actually four of them all the way around. Those were optical sensors looking out at the horizon, see the cold sky, warm ground. So it had a kind of what I would now call auto level. It also had piezo gyros for pitch and I guess you'd call it yaw. So it was stable in a hover, but without enough power, when I threw it in the air, and I literally threw it, I was hoping we'd be able to transition, but it never did, and it just basically came down tail first, landed softly, and fell over. So sadly, that was the end of that, because without enough power, what's the point? Now, along that same time, I also built this aircraft, and this was not intended to be a VTOL per se, although it did ultimately become one. Obviously, a very lightweight electric aircraft, but at the time, once again, brushed motor, external gear reduction on the propeller, and not shown in this picture because it was so heavy it would have crushed the airplane practically, was a big NICAD battery. And even with that big NICAD battery, it was only good for 2 or 3 minutes in the air. But it flew, and it actually lived for about 10 years. Eventually got upgraded to brushless motors, LiPo batteries, and then it began to shine a little bit, although it was still a very strange airplane to fly. The torque effects, I mean, it was like I would imagine a World War I fighter plane, you know. You turn left, it would climb. You turn right, it would dive. It was weird. But it flew, and it hovered too, by the way. So after the double ring wing, I thought maybe I'd learned my lesson. I'd try a different motor. In this case was an OS-61, which is a pretty powerful two-stroke. And you can see that great big tuned pipe, because I was determined to have enough power this time. And I built this design, and I thought a canard, and I put these great big control surfaces right up front. And I mean, literally, there's like 80% of the surface is the control surface. And part of that was the idea of getting control up far away from the ground, because I'd noticed these tail sitters, they have a tendency to get blown over. And I wanted to see if I could fight that. Well, what I didn't realize was, it wasn't going to work. It had one flight. It went up about 20 feet, and as soon as Zach, even with his cat-like reflexes, as soon as he pushed it into forward flight, it tumbled. Now, at the time, I didn't have the flight control system turned on. I thought we were just going to fly it like an airplane. But it didn't have enough surface area in the tail to stabilize itself. It didn't have any aero damping. And it was basically unflyable. So, and this is just some other pictures of it in various forms. One more, please. So I tried another. I thought I learned a lesson, and I put an X-wing in the back instead of the ring wing. And that was a little better. I managed to crash into the pits this time. Scared the heck out of me and quite a few other people as well. But, you know, the tale of success just goes on. So next one. Now, this was yet another, I guess you'd call it an X-wing. And I don't know if you can tell in the photograph, but this is made of something called coroplast. It's just this sort of plastic cardboard-like corrugated material. You see them on election time, they make signs out of it. And it turns out to be a wonderful prototyping material for these little model aircraft. It's very durable, you know, it almost bounces. In this case, a somewhat smaller engine, but a smaller and lighter aircraft. This actually did fly many times. It landed on its tail once, and that was only thanks to the fact that Zach is a very good pilot. But only once, and I never actually turned on the flight controller system with this one, just because I could see it wasn't going to get where I wanted to go. So all of that led to something I call the H-wing. I guess you can probably figure out why I call it an H-wing. And this actually worked, and I guess you could say this was the beginning of success. Now, I took that FMA co-pilot, the optical stabilization system, the gyros, and I also included something. Bob, you want to flip the slide? Something I call, for lack of imagination, the swing set landing gear. Now, Yeah, I know, it looks a little strange, but it worked. It would actually allow the airplane to go vertical or horizontal. Bob, show him the next slide and you'll see what I mean. So, and it had castering wheels on the bottom so it could actually roll out on the runway and then rotate itself to vertical. Literally, as soon as I flipped the switch in order to turn on the flight stability, it would pop to vertical. And then, of course, takeoff is easy. You just gun it. Landing was quite a bit harder, but it did it many times, actually. Roll stability on the way down was always really iffy. And Bob knows this. He's had this problem with tail sitters, too. You lose a lot of control authority when you're going backwards. But it did land several times and even flew in an air show once, so mild success. Now, finally, we're getting to the modern era, and by that I mean, you know, modern flight controllers. Now we're up to having brushless motors, LiPo batteries, MEMS gyros, accelerometers, in a commercially available package, something called an EagleTree Guardian. It has a nice little PC interface. I think they're a couple hundred bucks at the time. And this airplane almost succeeded. And by that, it could take off vertically. It could land almost vertically, but it couldn't hover. It could fly down to about 3 or 4 miles an hour. But below that, it would just kind of go wonky. That's a technical term. But close. And it did transition to forward flight and do the normal airplane stuff. So, Bob, finally, after, 30 years of this, I finally found something that kind of worked. And this is all Bob's fault, actually, because he said, why don't you make something out of a quadcopter? It'll be easy, he said. So I did. And I made this quad tilt wing. Now this is an ugly, ugly airplane, I know that. I'm proud of that, actually. Because by 30 years, I'd finally learned that if you want something to fly, you don't spend a lot of time making it pretty. You make it so that you can crash, you can be repaired, that you can iterate and modify, and that's what I did. And that's just the underside. You know, it's externally braced. I mean, it's ugly. But let's look at the video. And you'll see what I mean.
Cutting the grass. You have video or just still?
Video.
Yay.
So.
Thank you. All thanks to Bob.
Is everything a plane can do?
Outside recovery.
Yeah. This thing actually had two flight controllers in series. A Guardian and a KK2. I'll show you what that is in a minute.
Very nice.
Oh, good. I was afraid it was going to crash again. So let's move on. So after that success, I decided to sort of productize it a little bit. I took a standard off-the-shelf foam trainer. This is something called a Bixler, which is available from Hobby King for like under $100. And I modified it in this relatively simple way and documented it in great detail, published it out on the net, and there's people all over the world, maybe not hundreds of them, but a few people that have actually built this thing, and they've flown it too. So, and thank you, that's another good image, and you can see the flight controller on top and the receiver and stuff on top of the wing. Let's go ahead and look at the video. Now, Bob Parks, I think you were flying this one at this time. Maybe you'll recognize it. And this was here at Ames, yeah. Got to work on those transitions a little bit. Oh, it does loops. And rolls. Good flying. Now, there's much longer videos available out on the web, of course. I mean, I had to cut these way down because you didn't want to be here all night long. But, let's see if you can do a good landing this time.
Okay. Here we go. Diving into the transition. Flipping the switch.
Uh-oh.
Not fighting it.
You've seen this before?
Okay.
This is what happens when the aerodynamic...
Hey, I've become a glide.
This is what happens when the aerodynamic forces on the rotors overcome the servo and you get asymmetric rotor tilt. And basically the flight controller turns off because it thinks it's supposed to be in forward flight and you've got the rotors going the wrong direction and oh, it's bad. And it crashed several times before we finally figured that out, thanks to Walter, by the way. Walter back on the camera back there, who finally brought out his good quality video camera so we could actually see what was happening in the air. But we fixed it. I added stronger servos. That's all it was. Took a long time to figure it out, though. No, I don't have any crashes on this one. I'm sorry. I'll remember to do that next time. So this is something I call the VTOL Fun Cub. And what I was trying to do here is I wanted to make a VTOL that anyone could build in a weekend. Well, once again, I failed. It takes a couple of weekends. But this is a standard off-the-shelf trainer kit, not very expensive. Fun Cub's a wonderful little airplane. And you can see motor pods, nothing tilts here. It's just basically a quadcopter strapped to a Fun Cub. But the result is actually very nice. Bob, can we see the video here?
So it's very controllable. VTOLs tend to be very easy to hover anyway. Good yaw control. That's just a tiny partial stick. Pitch control, of course. Roll control. So I'm going to go ahead and switch into what's called slow forward flight, which turns on the front motor, but only at a partial throttle setting. And now we're cruising around, though I'm going to go ahead and do a full transition here and just demonstrate that it's still an airplane. Fun Cub's a wonderful little airplane. I mean, super easy to fly. Everybody loves them. This makes it a little heavier, of course, but it's still a, you know, a very gentle plane.
All right, we'll move it on. So all of that led to this aircraft, and I imagine many of you, or probably all of you in this room, recognize this as an XC-142. You know that they built these back in the 60s. They built five of them. And they were fairly successful as aircraft. You know, they crashed a few of them and some people died, of course. But and ultimately, the sad thing is that it never turned into an economic success. But you know all that. This is the model that I made. And let's just let the video tell the tale. Taking off! All right, here we go. Okay. Since we got such beautiful conditions, there's a little roll test there. We'll do the beauty spin here. Now this aircraft is in the back there. So now I'm going to go ahead and do a transition to slow forward flight. Nice sideways transition that you could see well. I won't do a lot of slow forward flight this time, just enough to give you a taste.
Okay, here we go.
Oh my God. It's actually very mild, it just goes in.
Transition.
This is still the most difficult VTOL I've ever made. It's crashed probably 8 or 10 times. You'll have to trust me, it landed after that. So I wanted to mention that currently the flight controller I use for all of these aircraft is based on a KK2. This is a standard off-the-shelf flight controller. It's available from Hobby King for about $20. So it's really quite cheap and accessible. Now, the firmware that goes in that, there's a gentleman by the name of David Thompson, who's, I'd like to say, a good friend of mine who I've never met. Now, David lives in Australia, and which is why I've never met him, and maybe I never will, but we have worked together closely for years now, because together we architected, or I architected and he coded, which means he did all the hard work, this firmware, which is not just capable of flying an XC-142, or it's basically almost any kind of VTOL, including the GL-10, the Grease Lightning. I assume you're familiar with that one. That the NASA guys at Ames built?
At Langley.
And that big old 50-pound or whatever it is airplane is flying this little tiny flight controller, the same flight controller in those aircraft back there. So, for $20. So the next thing I tried was, I won't call it a tail sitter, I guess you might call it a dog sitter. Well, you'll see what I mean by a dog sitter here in just a minute. Let's take a look at the video.
I'm out just in time for this, hopefully.
So it sits at about a 30-degree angle, and it actually hovers like that.
Sometimes you see if you caught your breath.
So it doesn't look like that should work, does it?
Now this is hover mode. Control's fine, but, you know, not really brightly. So now when I push into slow forward flight mode, you can see immediately wants to climb, and that's because there's less drag with the wings straight like that. Now I don't have to go
there it goes.
Forward flight when I'm in this mode. I can hover.
Yeah, it was hard to fly, hard to see.
I want you to go forward. Sorry, I got a little over our head.
Now that's a reverse transition. Right. You can see it just gradually kind of dropping the tail.
I'm going to go ahead and climb out. Sorry, I know you don't have like a zoom lens, but I need to.
And now this is iPhone video, so it's not quite as good as what Walter does, but it'll do. Kazra, I think you took this video. Oh, yeah, thanks, Kazra. I crashed it shortly thereafter, so thank you, Kazra. Yay. Whew, I get scared. So then came something I call the WUV, because as you know, everybody needs a little WUV. WUV stands for Wing Utility Vehicle. And it was kind of two things in one. One is it's a fantasy scale model of a plane that doesn't exist. It was envisioned as a light transport that could carry a Humvee for the Army. We've got a few Army people here, right? But it's also a test of a concept for optimizing the interaction between the wings and the rotors. So there's a little bit of technical content here. What we're trying to do is make it so that the wings and the rotors don't fight each other. They actually interact and help one another. So in this case, the lift rotors are mostly positioned behind the wing. They blow down the back of the flaps so that when the forward thrust motors blow mostly under the wing and under the flaps, that airflow gets turned. The wing never stalls. And, well, you'll see how it works here in just a second. So, I like that pretty picture. You know, makes it look big. So let's take a look at how it flies. Well, you went too far, Bob. Oh, you ruined the whole thing. Come on. Now you really ruined it. Okay.
It's all over already.
Yeah, yeah.
Drop in hover mode.
So the flaps are fully down. And it has, what is it, 16 plus 2 divided by pi, 18 motors, I think.
I'm going to go ahead and flip into slow forward flight here.
You notice how it gets so much quieter when you do that? I like that. Yeah. So it takes a lot less power.
We'll let it pick up a little speed, bring it back fairly close. So here we're going to do the transition now.
What you can't see is it just accelerates. It really zips when you do that transition.
And now I'm going to cut the throttle way back and let the nose come down. Now this would be the kind of descent you would do coming into a contested airfield. Okay.
You like that?
And now I'm going to power it up in slow forward flight mode.
Now the XC-142 can't do that.
Okay, let's make sure. And you notice they're all running now. Well, the front ones would too, and there we go.
So this is a short takeoff.
So here we go.
A very short takeoff.
So it's almost like cheating because it takes off in about 3 inches. But and certainly, as a model, it has enough power. It doesn't need to do a short takeoff. But as a full-scale aircraft, it would have huge advantages in terms of being able to carry more weight. All right.
So I promise you this is the only slide in the whole presentation. And the only reason I put this in here is I wanted you to know that this is not just a toy. Okay, it's mostly a toy. But it also has some utility as a research vehicle. I was able to get some actual in-flight data. In this case, the power required to make a transition from hover to fast forward flight. And this is actually 4 different transitions all overlaid on top of each other. The blue one at the bottom is where I was, as a pilot, pulling the throttle back. Now, these are all level transitions. The only difference is that the ones where the power goes up again is where it's actually accelerating rapidly, and then I pull the power out. The bottom one is where I pulled the power out throughout the transition. So you can see that it really does as you go faster, which everyone in this room already knew that, right? So there was a lot of other data gathered, but I promise not to bore you with that. So yeah, I want to move beyond some of the stuff that I've done and talk about some work that some other kids have done. And I say kids, these are high school students. John McNally and Jeff Barat. Now, they are high school students, just graduated literally a couple days ago from Menlo School. They designed and built this aircraft, the DA Walrus. I have no idea why they named it that, not why they built it. But as you can see, it's a tilt wing. And in about 3 months, these kids did. Wait a minute, you're here. Stand up and say hi. So I apologize for calling you kids. These young adults built this wonderful aircraft, designed and built it themselves. This is not a kit. No one told them exactly what to do. They came on the internet forums and we gave them some advice. Some of it was even good. But they built this thing. Well, let's go to the next slide. And I also want to point out that they're using tools that even I don't use. I'm not that great. But, I mean, they're using CAD, they're using 3D printing, and you tell them if I'm lying. But laser cutting, I mean, this is all, you know, the modern stuff, right? And they're using it. It's like no big deal. I mean, they've had this all their lives, right? So let's take a look at the videos. Now, it wasn't all success. I mean, they went through their learning curve just like everybody else. Let's go ahead and go, Bob. Uh-oh.
Take three.
Okay, this is good. Oh, God.
Oh, my God. Oh, my God. Oh, my God, it's flying.
Whoa.
Whoa.
Too fast. I got way too much right aileron. I can't turn right. The right hand approach the field here. It's gonna be rough.
Oh God.
Wow. Oh. Wow. Oh. Okay.
So this is, I guess, hovering in the quad or whatever you call it at the school. Now, by this time, they're getting pretty good. You might say they're getting kind of cocky. Now, what are they going to do with that table? What do you think? Hey! Oh, but it gets better, folks.
On the table, John, are you insane?
Hey! And this is out at Baylands Park. There they go.
Well, it's a little too fast.
So they did make the full transition, folks. Don't.
That was not a longer approach.
All right, let's read.
Great job, guys. So all this is leading to my final point for the night, and that is that we are blessed to be at a wonderful time here. We've got a convergence between all of these enabling technologies that are making all this possible. Some of them already here, the motors, the batteries, the speed controllers, the things that I didn't have 30 years ago. And some of them soon to happen. I mean, flight controllers are here, but you know, the autonomous flight control, well, even that's here. I mean, you guys have it, I'm sure. But I'm talking about here at a level that's cost effective for even me. And then on the other side of this, we've got all these reasons for this to exist. It's no longer just about the military or just about passengers, you know, human carrying vehicles. It's drones. Or if you don't like that term, UAVs. So, and there's so many good applications. I mean, these are real things. It's not just delivering pizzas, which I admit is a little silly. But, you know, there's law enforcement, private security, real estate people want to take pictures of properties. I mean, photography in general. There's, yes, they're trying to transport things, and they'll figure that out eventually. And there's all kinds of scientific purposes, weather, and they're using these things for archaeology and mapping. I know a guy who's got PG&E all excited because he's able to inspect their power lines. One day soon, your roofer is going to show up and he's going to bring one of these things out of the back of that big white panel truck. He's going to throw it in the air and he's going to inspect your roof. I mean, it's becoming that easy. So all of this leads to my final conclusion, which is right here, right now, is the golden age of eTOL. I mean, we are blessed to live in a time when all of these possibilities are all around us. I mean, we still haven't figured out what works the best, but boy, we're figuring out everything that doesn't work and everything that kind of works, and it's so cool. And in time, it'll be all, you know, boring and it'll all work great. But for now, it is just so cool. That's why it's the golden age of eTOL. Thank you. Before I forget, I need to make sure I thank some people. And Bob Ormiston, who roped me into this. Thanks, Bob.
Oh, you like it.
Yeah, I did. And Meredith, I know you all know Meredith. And without Meredith, we couldn't have put this slideshow together, especially the videos. And Paul Langston. Paul? Thank you, Paul. Paul did a lot of work on these videos. And Walter back there, taking the camera, who He shot many of these videos that you saw tonight. And of course, Bob Parks was flying in the video. And Robert Scott, thank you for the lovely meal. I get a free meal out of this. And let's see, Carl Russell? Did I say that right?
You got it.
Who is, what is it, the chapter president? Thank you, thank you, thank you. I'm sorry, I'm terrible with names. And I was told that I have to mention Bill, what is it, Wormbrot? Did I say that right?
That's funny.
Why? Why? I don't know.
Why?
Because he's a great guy, yeah.
We didn't do it, Bill would.
Anyway, that's my talk for tonight. And Bob is telling me I have to answer questions. Do you really have any?
We could ask lots of questions here, but could you share some of the constraints that you have encountered over time in terms of flying these in parks or in areas that would that you would seem to think were appropriate or available to you, but you were told, no, you're not allowed to do this?
Surprisingly enough, very little. Now, these aircraft are not very big. I mean, you can see they're in the back there. They're under 5 pounds. So they kind of fall under the purview of radio control model airplanes. For much of my modeling career, I flew at club fields, which were specifically for model airplanes, and they had no rules against it other than try not to crash in the pit so many times. But no, and even now, I primarily fly right here locally. There's Bayside Park, Baylands Park, I should say. At Lawrence Expressway and 237. And by the way, come on out there sometime. There is a ton of interesting stuff. You'll love it. But no, I haven't had a lot of problem like that. Anything else?
What's next?
Oh God, I don't know. There's always something. I just built an airplane that flies both forward and backwards. Well, not in the same flight, but... crashes in between sometimes.
What does your garage look like?
It's very neat and organized, thank you very much. Thank you, everybody. Good night.